you want to start by just telling me the latest death toll, if there's been any more people that have been found.
So with the death toll, you know, that's something that continues to rise by the hour, and we don't have a definite number yet. It continues to grow. As you can imagine, there's so much physical devastation that has caused the loss of life that our local ground crews, our EMTs, as well as our statewide officials are continuing to work through that and continuing to communicate. And so I know that they are making sure that we are all aware of any updates that we need, but there is not an update or a final number. And quite frankly, given what we're seeing, I don't know when there will be.
Okay. And has it risen above 70, I believe is what the governor was saying yesterday?
What the governor said is the most updated information that we have.
Okay. And now what, one question that a lot of people have, and I don't know if you've been briefed on this, is why did so many die at the candle factory? Why that one location? Was the shelter not sturdy enough? Did people not evacuate fast enough? Have you guys gotten any clarity on why that location was so deadly?
So obviously there's a high concentration of folks who were in the building, which would lead us to understand why there was a larger loss of life. In terms of being able to pinpoint the shelter structure, the practices and protocols that were going on in the factory at the time, those things are being evaluated. It's just too soon to be able to answer that question. But I can tell you with certainty that all of these decisions are being investigated and will be evaluated. And we have to learn from any mistakes that we may have made in that response, but certainly to make sure that we do the right thing moving forward as well for these families and for any future response that we may need.
And of course, everyone kind of looks to Florida as well with that building collapse. Do you think that there may be some coding changes, law changes that may come out of this?
There could be. That when it comes to building codes and structural preparation, I don't know that anything could have been sturdy enough to withstand a tornado of this magnitude. I mean, they're still evaluating. This could have been the longest a tornado that's been on the ground the longest in potentially history. And so I don't know that there is a way that you can possibly prepare for that, but there are certainly ways that we can learn from this and to do better as we move forward. And I can guarantee you that our folks on the ground at the local level and at the state level are certainly going to be looking at that.
Now, is there anything people should not be doing? Are there gawkers that are there? What is your message to people so that the crews that are cleaning up and also continuing rescue missions can do their jobs?
And that's a great point, Rachel. So for the folks who live in the area, we're asking them to stay in place, because for folks that are going to the areas that are the most devastated, what's happening is that is impeding the work of our first responders, our local officials, our state officials, and today the federal officials are going to be coming in, I believe, to Paducah. And so certainly if you are not from the area, do not go there. There is no reason for folks to be going there just to see the damage. You have social media. You can see all of the images almost in real time. And going there is not doing anything to help the local community. So please stay home. And if you want to help, you can certainly donate goods. And I know that we're doing a blood drive at your local blood bank. And there's also a website, Team WKY Fund at relieffund.ky.gov. So let me say that again, Team WKY relieffund.ky.gov. If you want to help, send your dollars that way and let our first responders do their work.
Okay. And now we've also seen, it seems like, great help from the federal government. Is what we're hearing in the media and from the Biden administration true? And also, is there anything more that they can be doing that any of the congressional leaders can be doing? I know that I've been in contact with Senator McConnell, Senator Paul, Congressman Comer. Is there anything that any more red tape that needs cut?
Well, that is certainly what everyone is working on together. And I can promise you that it doesn't matter where you're from or what your political party is. All of our elected officials in Kentucky are coming together because this is not a time for politics. This is a devastated area. Folks have lost family members. Hundreds and hundreds of families are suffering, not to mention the physical devastation and the communities that are ravaged right now. And so I have to say, Governor Beshear's leadership has been swift and compassionate, and President Biden has mirrored that at the federal level. He took the governor's calls yesterday. He immediately declared a state of emergency. And today, just a day after this emergency was declared, you're going to see a federal response team in, I believe it's Paducah, with Homeland Security, FEMA, those types of folks who are coming in to survey the damage, to be able to make sure that they can get our folks the resources they need. And I can't tell you how much that I appreciate that, not just as Lieutenant Governor, but, you know, someone who is a teacher in a school, who is a mother, who, you know, has family. You want to, this is what you want to hear from your government, is that they are there to help.
And now, of course, there are people, hundreds, thousands without power. It's cold out. People have medical devices. Are there any issues that you're seeing with issues people getting, with people getting generators? Say someone has a medical device that needs charging, who should they be reaching out to?
So you're right. And actually, I think the last conversation I had with the governor yesterday was about getting generators specifically to our school buildings, because our school buildings are housing a lot of folks right now and taking care of communities like they do every day. But if folks are having trouble with generators, with power, there are local response teams with our EMTs, mayors, judge executives, you know, first responders. They are in your area. The state has sent, I believe, over 180 on our response team, our strike team, immediately. And you're going to see more as the federal folks get there and survey the damage. And so there are people in your area that you can reach out to. They are right there. Let them know the challenges that you're facing. And for folks on the outside, this is why your dollars are important. It is mid-December, and there are folks who have lost everything. And, you know, it just breaks my heart to think about how they were planning for probably a Christmas in a couple weeks. And now they're unable to even find heat, and they don't have shelter. And that breaks my heart. And so, again, this is why this fund is important.
And are there any issues with people being able to reach 911? Is 911 operational? And also, are cell towers down?
The reception is spotty. If you're using cell phones in the area, the reception is spotty because of, obviously, of all the damage that's been done, but also the influx of folks to help. And so what I would say is, if you don't need to be utilizing any kind of internet or power, please don't. Let the folks in the area use what they need. But also all of those folks and places are operational, and they're getting support, not just from, you know, it's not just the local people that are there. It's now state, and eventually it'll be federal as well. So they do have support, and it is operational. But we need to be mindful of, again, not going to the area if you're not from there, staying in place if you are from there, and making sure that we, again, send our dollars and be mindful of the folks who are dealing with something that the rest of us can't fathom.
And if you, I know you're saying stay in place, but of course there are elderly people there and also possibly people with disabilities. If you are possibly in your home and you are safe, is it okay for you to go next door? And should you be going next door maybe daily, checking on your neighbor if they are living alone or elderly? Is that something that would help first responders so that is one less door they have to knock on?
Yes, and that's a great point, Rachel. When I say stay in place, I mean, don't go to the areas where you see the most physical devastation, but certainly if you are in a place where you can check on your neighbors, do that. And that's what we're seeing in the areas is these folks know their neighbors, they know the folks they go to church with, that they go to school with, and they're checking on each other. And that will only help our first responders make sure that they have access to all of the information they need for every household, because they're going house by house. Well, for the ones that are left standing right now, they're going house to house and checking on folks to make sure that they're safe. But when I say stay in place, stay in a safe, warm place. If you don't have heat or power or any of those types of things, you need to go find shelter. But again, don't congregate around the areas that are the most physically devastated, because that's where the response teams are.
Okay, and now I can see that at one point you did get pretty emotional talking about seeing this devastation. What is it like on the ground? I mean, what have you seen? And I'm looking at GMA right now. It's terrible. What has this been like for you personally to be witnessing this firsthand?
I don't know that you could ever be prepared for something like this to happen to you if this is your family, but I certainly don't know how you could prepare for something like this if you're in a position as an elected official where your job is to help people. And so we're listening and we're there to witness, to be on the ground with people who are in need and to hear from them. And it's heartbreaking. It is heartbreaking. You know, I've been on the phone with the governor several times, and again, his leadership is steadfast. It's swift, but it's compassionate, because this is not just about buildings. This is not just about, you know, economic devastation. These are Kentuckians, and these are families who are hurting. And that's who they are first and foremost to us.
Okay, and I don't want to take up most of your time today. So my last question is, what day is the president coming to Kentucky, and do you know where exactly he will be going?
So that has not been confirmed yet. The president is coming to Kentucky, but he has been very clear to the governor that he is waiting until his arrival will not impede the response, which I appreciate. And so I know that that's something that is important to everyone. And while I know the president cares and he's coming and he's sending his officials already, he's not going to be here until he knows that his presence won't impede the response. And I appreciate, number one, the immediate declaration of emergency. And second, that his federal folks will be on the ground today. But third, that he cares enough to know that his presence could cause a holdup in response. And so he's going to wait until he gets the all clear to be able to come and actually be on the ground in Western Kentucky. So stay updated for that. I'm sure the governor will be able to announce that once he knows.
Okay. And I guess that is not my last question, because I just realized I didn't ask one of the most important questions. How long is the cleanup going to take? We're on going into day two now. Are we starting to see some roads getting clear? And are there still a lot of areas that that crews haven't been able to even check for any loss of life?
I don't know that there's an answer to how long this will take, because we don't truly know the full scale of this devastation just yet. And so again, it's one step at a time, one day at a time. First and foremost is taking care of families who have lost life. Certainly the physical devastation is what's most visible to us. And so that's certainly being addressed as well. And that's going to be ongoing. But again, something that we have to continue to think about and anticipate is the long-term response and recovery for folks who have lost everything. This did happen overnight. It's not going to be fixed overnight.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Lieutenant Governor. I appreciate your time, and you, I would say, have a good day, but I guess just stay strong out there and be safe. I know it's a dangerous area to be right now.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Rachel. Appreciate it.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.